Hi guys, and welcome to my review of the SeeAudio Yume2. I know I'm a little bit late to the party, but only now I was able to actually get my hands on it. I received it last week because I wasn't quick enough to get it from the first batch of Yume2s that were produced. But anyway, what is important is I finally have it, and I've been able to listen to it over the last couple of days, and I can now give you my take on the Yume2. Anyway, just firstly, let's just get the box out of the way. It's got this. Okay, open this up. Inside here, the usual paperwork that we get that we don't really do anything with it. The IEMs came over there. Over here came the case, which I'll show it to you in a second. Nice selection of tips. They look like the KB Euro 7 tips. The yellow tipped ones, which are the large size, are the ones I'm actually using. So if I'm going to give any sort of a nitpick, the plastic here is a little bit on the little bit cheap side, but overall the whole appearance and the whole vibe of the box, of the presentation, of the unboxing experience is nicely done. As you know, the Yume is a 1+2. It uses Sonian BAs and a 10mm driver. And yeah, I mean, the graph over there is very similar to the graph that I was able to get myself. And that's it. 17 ohms impedance, sensitivity is 113 dBs, so it's relatively easy to run, although of course it benefits from connecting it up to a proper DAC amp or you know, a proper source, let's put it that way. Anyway, that's out of the way. The box, as I was saying, that's the box. Nice, you know, it's got a nice quality feel to it. I would have liked if this perhaps, instead of being printed on, was engraved, but again, it's just a little minor nitpick of mine. Inside, there's a nice detail, which is the fact that the cable can be held down with this little clip or strap, or whatever you want to call it. Nice finish on the inside. You know, it's got quality. You can feel there's a quality feel to the whole thing. As for the IEMs themselves, well, first things first. The cable, personally, I didn't find it offensive or bad. I know that some other people did complain about the cable. Personally, I really didn't find any issue with it. The one thing I did to it, which is the what I usually always do, is I gave it a nice tug to try and do away with the kinks and stuff that it has, you know, caused by being wrapped up as it was. And honestly, it's fine. I mean, like I said, it doesn't offend me. Would I have liked to have seen a modular cable? Yes, I would have liked. If not the modular cable, at least a better quality cable. You know, one IEM that jumps to mind that actually brings a very nice cable in stock format is the BGVP Melody. It brings a really nice cable. It's a modular setup, and it's an IEM that costs $100. So I'm sure that on an IEM that costs $200, that could have been done. As for the IEMs themselves, nice full metal shell, not really heavy. It's got an acceptable weight to them. They fit very nicely in my ears. I have absolutely no control. Fingerprint magnet, as you can see. There we go. Nice. This one's also full of magnet of fingerprints. It's just to clear up nicely. There we go. Nice faceplate. Really nice faceplate. That faceplate actually is something that it adds to that sense of premiumness to it. Anyway, like I was saying, fit is fine in my ears. Isolates very nicely. It's not fatiguing to, you know, to wear them. The nozzle length is good enough so that it actually allows the earphone to sit nicely inside your ear. And that's it. I mean, in terms of hardware and so on and accessories, it's well equipped. Let's put it that way. If there is any issue, really, is the fact that at $200 and to kind of also confirm what some other fellow reviewers did say, you know, the fact that it's $200 puts it in a price which is very makes it very competitive. And at $200, you have a, and below that $200 bracket, you have a lot of really high quality IEMs, and you know, it's especially the planars that came out this year. I mean, you know, you got the original Wuzetian at $150. You have the Hey Bay, which came out recently, $179. You have the S12 Pro as well at about $159, $160. All of those planars very much capable of resolution and detail and that typical treble that the planar is known for being able to give, which easily supplant the majority of hybrid offerings. And especially when you're talking about a 1+2, then for you to be able to do that, it makes it even harder. But the truth is, SeeAudio did you know, come together in terms of thinking it out properly, and the sound that the Yume2 has is quite magical. You know, from the first moment I actually put it on, the first, you know, that first impact that you get, and with an IEM, the first impact that I got with the Yume2 was the sense of space, of size. So stage, 3D-ness, let's put it that way. It's very much a characteristic of a really good planar, and this does it extremely well. And especially considering it's a 1+2, I even give it extra extra points for that. Anyway, what did I use to listen to it? What do I have in front of me here to compare it with before I, you know, go into more detail about the sound and so on and so forth? I used my TK2. I used my NX7 mainly with the Shanling, the UA3, so that I could get usage of the AKM deck. I used my M15 as well, my Q-Style, and I used my DX3 Pro. But I would say 80% of the listening was done with either one of these two. With the AKM, I ended up, this combo, I ended up liking more the sound here. I don't know, it can be maybe just a personal thing. It's just, I just like this combination. It's got a really nice, warm, lush kind of sound. The TK2 is more clinical, more clean, perhaps more correct. I'm not going to say otherwise. And it plays really well, and it matches really well with the Yume2 as well. Just me personally, I actually preferred, or I actually prefer this combination with the majority of the IEMs that I listen to. In terms of the IEMs, what do I have here? Well, because of the price that it has, it of course has straight away to start with two very big competitors, namely the Mega 5P from Hisenior, which initially was, you know, you could get it for $189. It's now $219, and you have some with some discounts that that I can link below. And then just recently the Aful Performer 5 came and kind of wreak havoc, $219, and I've seen it at $215. You know, 1+4 with all this technology as well that they've implemented, 3D printed shell and all this smart technical solutions that they found for matching the drivers. So this came and wreaked havoc in the market. But besides these two, it obviously made sense to have some comparison with the Yume, in this case the Yume Midnight. I don't have the original Yume. And then the other three are IEMs that, for me at least, they made sense because they have a lot of similarity in terms of the sound, and it just made sense. One is one that's not very spoken about, which is the 7th Acoustic Stargazer. Tremendous IEM for $165, if I'm mistaken. Tremendous IEM. The other one is is something that had my hand on it, which is the Akros Erasmus. Again, you know, it's perhaps not correct of me to be talking about it, but again, the truth is, it sounds good. It is a really good IEM, and I'm super happy that you know, this level of performance was achieved. And the other one is an oldie, well, oldie, but in the sense that it's been around for about a year now, just over a year, which is the Softears, the volume, also a 1+2, and this one is actually the most expensive one out of the whole bunch. It's $279. So 279, 219, 219, 189, 169, 135, and the Yume at $200, 199. Okay, so let's talk sound. I've got my notes here, so you guys will forgive me. I just, you know, I jotted down things as I went along, and it's important for me to give some organization to what I'm about to say. What can be said about the sound of the Yume2? Well, it's a mild V, a very mild V, okay. And besides the straight away the first factor which jumps to mind, which is its sound stage, which is really, really good. It's tall, it's wide, it's got depth. It's really, really good sound stage. Besides that, the other thing that straight away comes or becomes very noticeable is that the marriage between the two BAs and the DD was very well done. Nothing overpowers nothing else. And the transition, in my opinion, is very seamless from one part of the spectrum, of the frequency spectrum, to another part. In terms of the bass, it's a full bass. It's got absolutely no problems in handling whatever you give it in terms of music genres. It's not a bass head IEM by no means. I'm not saying that, but it's not a lean sounding IEM either. So it's a bass that can do everything well, and it works well with all genres. So from EDM to jazz to classical, it will handle everything perfectly. Stuff like bass guitar, it's got cleanliness, it's dynamic, it's you know, the marriage between the sub bass and the mid bass is being very well done. There's enough slam to make everything very engaging and to just give that necessary warmth, you know, carrying over into the mids, and giving it that sense of lushness, of warmth, that is good. But it's a clean bass, super textured, super detailed, doesn't get itself into trouble, handles power really well. So bass department, top marks. Mids, vocals are super engaging. They've got a nice dynamic sense to them, male and female vocals alike. There's no sibilance, there's no harshness in the mids. Super detailed. Very, very detailed, honestly. You know, there's no forwardness. There's nothing. The mids have been very, very well done. I mean, in that aspect, again, you can see that SeeAudio took their time and they tuned it. They didn't just throw parts together. They tuned it. The harmonics, everything, very well done. Nothing. Although there's a little bit of a wavy format from 2 to about 8K on the graph, there's nothing that really peaks above each other. If anything, there's a slight tendency to slowly go down past 2K. It slowly goes down, but it's really, honestly, very, very well done. Treble, again, the same thing. Detailed. It has enough energy to complement the upper mids and to give that sense of air to make sure that the detailed retrieval comes across as well as it comes across. and complement the bass. So there's no lack of energy. No, you don't feel that. Oh, okay, there should be a little bit more there, and the Yume is lacking. No, everything. The whole. I think the best way to actually describe the Yume2 is that it's a very natural sounding hybrid. It's got detail, a good balance between the frequency range, and it's very non-fatiguing, but at the same time, it's engaging. There are some IEMs that sometimes are just over fun, and after a while you just get tired of them. And on the other end, there are other IEMs that are just so neutral that, yes, they might be good if you're trying to fall asleep, but then, when things you want a little bit of excitement, they just can't do it. And in the Yume2, that balance of between being smooth and relaxed and natural sounding and having really good timbre and really good tonality and everything sounding very correct in terms of the instruments and how they are and the vocals and the male voices and the female voices and all of that. That balance between that, but at the same time also being energetic enough to be fun, that you put an EDM song or you put a rap song and it gets your foot tapping and you're excited to listen to it. It does it all very, very well, really, really well. If there is a true flaw, or not a flaw, but a true problem that the Yume2 has, is that it kind of was confronted by a lot of really good IEMs that came out this year, and especially the planars that came out were really good and cheaper. You had some really good DDs coming out as well, and also cheaper. And you had a couple of hybrids coming out, 1+4s, namely the, like I mentioned, the Performer and the Hisenior. That are very, very good as well, and kind of falls victim of its own thing. It's I don't know. Perhaps if it had been the first one to come out, it would have had a different success. But being late to the party to a certain extent, I think that didn't help. Also, the fact that they had all of these delays with the production and all of these factors are detrimental to a success, of an IEM. And in this market where things move so quickly, it's hell. Anyway, I guess in terms of the whole balance of sound and the technical abilities, I've been able to explain really well how the Yume is a capable IEM. What's left now for me to do is actually compare it then with the rest. The first I'll compare it with is with the original, well, sorry, the Midnight Edition of the Yume. And compared to the Midnight Edition, the Midnight Edition has got a little bit more sub bass, but overall, it's compared to the actual original Yume. Yes, it is more detailed. There's more treble, and there's a little bit more engagement in the sub bass. So it went from being a very neutral, boring sounding IEM to a more engaging IEM. But when you take this and you compare it to the Yume2, there's again a leap forward in a positive manner in the Yume2. It's got, although a little bit less sub bass, it's got more bass, it's more mid bass, more the mids are better quality, the highs are better quality and in more quantity. So overall, the whole sound of the Yume2 in terms of its balance, is superior to the Yume and Midnight. And in terms of technicalities as well, technicalities and especially the sound stage and the imaging of the Yume2 compared to the Midnight, there's no comparison, honestly. It's like I said, you listen to this the first time, and I'm sure 9 times out of 10, the first thing that will jump to you is how grand, how big it sounds. Okay, so compared to the Midnight, it has been a significant improvement, and an improvement that has come at not much more extra cost. Okay, so that's out of the way. The next one I think worthwhile comparing it to is the volume. And those that follow me know that I like the volume, and I think the volume is a great sounding IEM. But when you compare it to the Yume, you see straight away that although really good, and although it's got plenty detail and you know it's a well-executed IEM in many aspects, the Yume offers exactly the same performance, plus what? Plus being more polished, more balanced, better quality upper mids and treble than in, on the volume, and a good $80 cheaper. So you have more IEM in terms of sound with less cost, and especially in terms of its technicalities, the Yume2 exceeds the performance or passes the performance of the volume. So the volume kind of becomes redundant because, you know, why would you go and pay that extra money when you have an IEM that is cheaper and better? So that also gets this out of the way. So that's out of the way. And as they say, and then there were four. All right, so let's put these four a little bit closer. Yeah, all right. Let's start then. Well, let's start with my IEM, with the Erasmus. And this is actually going to be, I don't know, I want to try and not sound that I'm biased, but I really would like those that do have the Erasmus, I'm sure you will agree with what I'm about to say. The area where the Erasmus really loses out to the Yume2 is in the above, let's say above 6-7K, in the way that the upper mids and treble are done here is not as polished as it is here. It's also a 1+2, but it just is not as correct. The Erasmus in terms of bass performance, considering it's only got an 8 mm driver and it hasn't got any anything of a fancy diaphragm material or anything, it's got really nice bass. It's clean, it's detailed, it's fast, and in my honest opinion, it keeps up really well with the bass of the Yume2. Yes, the Yume2 ultimately does have does it edge it out. Yes, it does. But it keeps up very well in the bass. It keeps up very well in the mids as well. Male vocals, female vocals. The neutrality of this tune is very good because it also has that ability, like the Yume2, to be engaging. Where then it becomes evident that it falls behind the Yume2 is in the higher frequencies. And of course, it comes down to the fact that also the BAs used here are better quality, and that does dictate the extra performance that you're getting here, as opposed to the Erasmus. But the truth is, at $135, I'm super happy with what was obtained here in terms of performance, and the fact that it actually is able to trade blows with the Yume2 for me is already a favorable point. It's already a win because if I have to compare this to the Midnight, it performs on the level or exceeds the performance of the Midnight much more easier than you would think. And compared to the volume, yes, the volume is ultimately capable of edging out again the Erasmus in its higher frequencies, but at twice the price, you know. I don't know. Anyway, I'm happy with how this comes out in terms of its comparison with the Yume2. The Yume2, yes, is a superior IEM, but this keeps up very well, better than the other two so far, in my opinion. Okay, then this then ultimately leaves us with these three. The Hisenior. The Hisenior is all about being very neutral, very correct sounding. And in that aspect, yes, if ultimately I was looking for something which I was going to be using for monitoring or something or something of the sort, I would probably say that that would be the wiser choice. By that, I'm not saying that this is colored or anything of the sort. No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that the neutrality that this set has renders itself better to that kind of usage. And when you listen to one and the other, the thing that straight away, you know, is very easy to distinguish between the two is that great sound stage, that great air, that sensation of 3D that the Yume2 has, which is not as present there. It's a little bit more laid back on the Hisenior, on the Mega 5P. So for me to say that this is better than that or that is better, it's not a fair assessment, you know, it's not. That is more neutral. This is a slight mild V. That will be better suited for monitoring. This will be a better all-rounder, okay? So that's the Mega 5P out of the way. Then it leaves us with these two, the Aful and the Stargazer. The Stargazer is probably the one that's going to come closest to delivering an overall performance which is very similar to the performance of the Yume 2. Its problem is, in my opinion, availability. It's not an easy IEM to get hold of, and that ultimately will then dictate its success. It's got great bass, really, really nice bass, superior to the Yume, in my opinion, in that it is able to dig deeper. It's got more rumble than the Yume 2. Mid bass is about the same. Mids, actually, the curve very much follow each other, just less energetic on the Stargazer than here, which overall will give you a tonality or a sound which is a tad little brighter here as compared to there. But again, and very similar to the situation that happened with the Mega 5P, I cannot say that one is better than the other or that one outright. No, there's a difference in price here of around $30. There is the fact that this is not easily available or as easily available as the Yume, although mind you the Yume has had these issues with the production falling behind. I would say that this is a very, very capable IEM of offering a performance very similar to the Yume 2, with again being capable of trading blows across the board. The Yume 2 ultimately does beat the Stargazer in terms of its technicalities. So soundstage is better, imaging is better, and I would also say that detail retrieval is better than the Yume 2 over that. Okay, but the differences are minor. Please keep in mind the differences are minor. All right, so that's Stargazer out of the way. And then this leaves us with the troublemaker, the Aful. And the Aful is an IEM that some have liked, some have considered to be a real market. You know, I'm not going to say market shaker or market breaker, but something that has come along and offered a performance that you usually find in IEMs way, way more expensive at a, let's say, budget price. And when you take that into account, you know, being a OnePlus 4 and offering the various technical solutions that they've implemented on the Aful, if you take that into account, then straight away the Aful is the better option. Yes, it is. That's just the way it is. It's the better option. Does that mean that the Yume 2 doesn't have the same kind of R&D applied to it? No, obviously it does, because it's a OnePlus 2 that it's able to play, to trade blows. I mean, you can't go wrong with either one of these two, to be honest. You cannot. Where then are the differences? Where then are the areas where you can distinguish the two of them? The first area, and again, and this is kind of a recurring thing, is the soundstage. The soundstage on the Yume 2 is crazy good. Crazy, crazy good. And it's better than the Performer 5. Period. It's as simple as that. It's a better soundstage than on the Performer 5. Having said that, the imaging on the Performer 5, for some reason, maybe because of the stuff that I listened to, I found the imaging to be slightly better than on the Yume 2. Detail retrieval is about the same. I really didn't find any difference in terms of the detailed retrieval. And then timbre and tonality is the other area where, again, personally, I feel that the Aful is slightly edging out again the Yume 2. Why? Because it's got a nice sub bass focus, but that sub bass focus is not at the cost of losing any sort of ability in the mid bass. I found the mid bass to be just as quick, just as capable, but that extra sub bass that it has, somehow it just adds on to the mids in a way that confers instruments just that little extra tonality that I personally like. It's a hard one to explain, but it's kind of the same thing that happens a little bit, and forgive me some of you what I'm about to say. It's kind of what happens with the Blarno 3. You listen to the Blarno 3, and although you can feel that, yes, things are excessive in certain parts of the spectrum, you also feel that there's just something that is just so engaging. And I'm guessing it has to do with how the harmonics and how the different resonances come into play with, you know, how the IEM actually sits into your ear and everything. And it just makes it sound so cozy, so warm. And that's the kind of the feeling that I get personally when I listen to the Aful. While on the Yume 2, when I put it on, I get and I'm greeted with that sense of space and a very lush kind of sound, a very, you know, really nice. It's a really nice, how can I put this? It's just very classy, okay? On here, you have the same thing, okay? But it's just got that little extra warmth, that little extra lushness. If I was to put this in terms of cars, it's like I'm comparing a Mercedes, an S-Class, okay, here. And this is a Maybach. This is maybe perhaps not the very best comparison. Or let me make it another way. This is a Rolls-Royce, a Phantom, and this is a Maybach. They both are very, very luxurious, very comfortable. They all have, you know, quality coming out of their pores. Everything is, you know, everything is about showing off how grand they are. But it's not that one is better than the other. They just are slightly different in their way they approach or they offer you that luxury. And that's exactly what happens here. Honestly, you cannot go wrong with either one of them. They have a very similar type of final sound reproduction. A little bit more soundstage and a little bit more airiness here than on the Aful, a little bit more lushness here than on the Yume 2. But overall, the rest is, it's just trading blows all the time. It's just trading blows. So, yeah, that's it, guys. I know this is a long review, but I really wanted to compare the Yume 2 and give it its deserved light, you know, time to shine. Because I really feel that I think it has fell victim to its own delay in coming out. If this had come out in the first 6 months of 2022, this thing would have been an absolute market success. It would have been. I have absolutely no doubts that if this had come out in the first 6 months of last year, everybody would have been talking about it. And SeeAudio just kind of, I don't know. I think it's the same situation that's happening with the Mu, their tribrid, which they decided to offer it only on the Japanese market. I can be wrong, or I could be wrong, but I think that when it eventually comes out for the rest of the world, and I'm assuming they are planning that, it's really not going to be a success. And I actually honestly think that they perhaps opted even for having it only for the Japanese market, because they already knew that the Mu wasn't going to be a success in the global market, because of how competitive that market is. Anyway, guys, that's my take here on the Yume2. Fantastic IEM, well tuned, a very good sounding, and yeah, it's another option. Apart from the Performer 5, the Mega 5 from the Mega 5P from Hisenior, and the Stargazer, which is kind of like the dark horse here. The Stargazer again is an IEM that I feel that if it had a little bit more marketing going for it, it would have been it could have been and would be more successful. I mean, actually, one of the reasons why I think that the Performer 5 was successful to a greater extent was the fact that they were very savvy. Hi-Fi Go was very savvy with the way that it promoted this IEM. They were very smart. They knew that they had to get this IEM on the hands of the right people, and that's it. And the rest is history. And it's been a success for them. And I'm glad that they were aggressive with that approach, because otherwise, it would have been an IEM that if had them not been as diligent in putting it out there for people to listen to it, it would have probably fell into the just another IEM draw. I mean, I remember people just joking about the name Aful. Okay, so it's an awful IEM. I mean, Aful, it's a name. It's a name like Moondrop. It's a name like Softears. Anyway, guys, that's just me rambling away now. I'll show you the graphs now next, and that's it. Okay, like and subscribe as usual. Any questions you guys might have, please feel free to ask, and I'll see you in the next one. Hi guys, and so welcome to the graph section of this Yume2 review, and straight away this is the graph of the of my Yume2 using the BGVP07 tips, and you can see straight away indicators of what I was mentioning. I realized that my graph compared to some other graphs is slightly different in this area. Some of the other graphs that I've seen show this area a little bit less prominent, but this area here, this whole way that this area here is done, is indicator of that sound stage or that 3D-ness that the Yume2 has. It's all because of this. And if you remember IEMs like the Olina SE, they all have this kind of characteristic, and every time you see an IEM that has this kind of characteristic here, you can be rest assured that it will most likely have a very good 3D effect. But anyway, as I was mentioning, you can see it's got a nice sub bass, marrying into the mid bass very nicely by 300 hertz, not even 200 and something hertz. It's flat already, very progressive, smooth pin again, peaking at around 2.5 and then plateauing. And although it's got a little bit of those ups and downs, nothing jumps out. I mean, everything stays within a window of 79 to 88, so 9 dBs. Really nice, really, really nice. That dip there is not that much lower than the dip of the mids. Everything is just really, really well executed, in my opinion. There's nothing that can this has been done wrong. Let me show you straight away with the Softears, the volume. That's with the volume. I've centered all the diagrams at 500 hertz, so 500 hertz is the commonality. And in the bass is really not where you see the big difference with regards to the volume. Where you do see the difference to the volume is that for some reason, and although graphically that's not what you see, but for some reason the volume just sounds a little bit artificially bright, okay, as compared to the Yume 2. And then yes, you do see that it's a little bit more recessed in the way that, this part of the mid-range is done. It just sounds a little bit more laid back with regards to male vocals and female vocals in this particular part, especially male vocals, okay? So that's the volume there, out of the way. This next one is actually, I'll show you the Midnight, the Crin Edition. And as you can see, the Crin Edition, it's got a little bit more sub bass, yes, but because it also is very kind of neutralish on the mids and upper mids and presence area, it kind of makes it a little bit lifeless as compared to the Yume 2, okay? It's very neutral, very smooth sounding, yes, but it's also not as fun and as engaging. The extension is decent, but the Yume 2 has got more extension. So that's that out of the way. Let me show you the Erasmus. That's the Erasmus there. And as I said in the review, it's not the bass where you see the difference to the Yume 2. It's not in the way the initial pin again is done, or even the way that it's kind of both of them plateau across the majority of the mids, the upper mids and presence area. This is very similar. It's over there past 10k that you see that the Yume 2 has got more energy, and that more energy is noticeable in it just being a little bit more clean, a little bit more detailed. It's got that little extra amount of, you know, shine, good shine, obviously, and of course the sound stage is that technicality in particular is very, very good. So that's the Erasmus there. Next one. Let me show you the Hisenior, which is this one. And the Hisenior, again, if you recall a little bit earlier, it's all about being very neutral. And although there's a lot of similarities here, but it's very neutral. It sounds really good, very neutral, very correct sounding if what you ultimately are wanting is monitoring. It just is not ultimately as fun with regards to certain genres. I mean, nothing offensive, no, please, by no means, but it just, the Yume 2 has just got that little extra amount of energy which just, you know, engages you, captivates you, and keeps you there for that little extra longer. All right, so that's the Mega 5P out of the way. I've shown you the Midnight. I've shown you the Softears. Ah, yes, let's go now to the 7th Acoustics, the Stargazer. And I think the graph speaks for itself. The bass is basically the same, just a little bit of extra sub bass below, especially below 40 hertz, okay, which you do notice. Mind you do notice, and it just conveys that little extra, much like the Aful, and I'll show you now the Aful in a second. It conveys just that little extra amount of fullness that is very nice. As you can see, then the pin again is basically the same thing. I mean, this year is almost identical. And again, the Stargazer has got really good technicalities, although the Yume 2 does just slightly edge it out. Again, I wouldn't say that one is better than the other. I mean, the Mega 5P and the Stargazer are two IEMs that are basically just trading blows with the Yume 2. And were it not for the fact that it's difficult to get hold of the Stargazer, or more difficult than what would be preferred. You know, it's an IEM that is equally capable, and an IEM that I would also say, get it, you can't go wrong with it, okay? And then finally, the Performer 5, which is this one, yeah, exactly, the Performer 5. There we go. And again, we have another situation where the tuning is very similar to what the Yume2 is tuned like. The interesting thing about the Performer is that although it's got an 8mm driver, it's got that, as I was saying a little bit earlier, it's just got that little extra weight that just makes it more, while one is clean and detailed and you know, and very correct and classy, the other one is clean and very classy and equally detailed, but it's just got that little extra warmness, you know. It's the situation of the Rolls-Royce and the Maybach that I was mentioning. And you can't go wrong, you can't really falter. The only area that, yes, I will give the Yume2 an edge is in the sense of the soundstage. You do feel that it has got a slightly better soundstage. It's more expansive, larger. But overall, it's like I was saying. There's a few IEMs here that are IEMs that you can choose safely without having any issues. If it's the Stargazer, okay. You can't go wrong with the Stargazer. It's a well-tuned, well-done IEM. I mean, you just look at the space curve. I mean, by 300, it's there, it's flat. There's no bleed, no nothing. Perfect. So Stargazer, perfect IEM. If you choose the Aful, again, the same situation. You can't really go wrong. There's nothing here that's going to be, in my opinion, considered offensive. Everything stays within, again, a nice tight margin. We're talking 79... 87, so 8 dBs more or less. So, you know, that's actually a characteristic that I've mentioned a few times before. Keeping things within a nice, you know, barrier usually is a good indicator that it will be a good sounding IEM. One such IEM that when you look at the graph, you kind of are a little bit afraid, and then when you actually listen to it, you see, oh wow, this plays really well, is the ISN, the H50. You know, I can just show it to you quickly. You know, you look at the diagram, at the graph, and you think to yourself, this is gonna hurt, this is not gonna be great. And then when you listen to it, okay, that's the ISN, the H50. Let me take away that. You know, you look at this graph and you think, oh my god, what is this? And the truth is, when you actually listen to it, it sounds so good. And why? Because everything stays within, so 84, about 8 dBs. Everything stays in a nice, not even 7 dBs, I would say. Yeah, 7 dBs. You know, that's good. Anyway, this is not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is the Yume2. So, Yume2, you can't go wrong with it. A full Performer 5, you can't go wrong with it. 7th Acoustics, Stargazer, you can't go wrong with it. And Where is it? There we go. Mega 5P from Hisenior, you can't go wrong with it. And you're looking at the graphs here, and you can see that all of them, up to about 2K, they are basically the same. It's just the way they then handle that area above there. Some are more neutral, some are a little bit more energetic. And then it's the extension past 10K that also is a differentiating factor. But any one of these four, you can't go wrong. The ones that obviously are surpassed and any one of these four does a better job is the Softears volume and the SeeAudio, Kryn edition, the Midnight. Those two IEMs, any one of these four is better. I mean, even the Erasmus, ultimately, I guess I could even throw it in there, but I'm not going to talk about it, so I don't sound biased. That's it, guys. Again, like and subscribe. any questions that you might have, please feel free to ask, and I'll see you in the next one. Take care.